I'm gonna start with, Jen's signed in, I guess everybody's signed in, hopefully. I think what we should do is probably, there's a lot of people like, them talk first before we, start with regular business. So, we'll open up the floor to anybody who wants to say anything. You're welcome to. And it was pretty fun. Yes, go ahead, Jeff.
It's my understanding that you're looking at, increasing all the way for the existing postman farm?
Nope. And where did you hear that?
The internet, so it's gotta be true, right?
No, the town, set the wind overlay zone through the town land use and development code, our zoning code. And we did that in 2013. We came up with the zone. There's probably a map around here somewhere. It's basically north of 72, east of the...
So it's just Hopkins, that's looking to change it.
Yeah, and we had not even thought about or talked about expanding the wind overlay zone.
I guess that was my question, is in the future, if this goes through, is that also gonna be a matter of them proposing to change the outline of it, and it's gonna happen? That's the process?
I did get an email from Avangrid, and they told me in the email, they have no intention of, expanding outside our wind overlay zone.
But you and I know that's not a binding, that's them telling you what they...
Well, if they want to expand, they're gonna have to approach the town again, and, we'll have to go through a change to the land use development code, zoning code. And that's quite involved. We have to have public hearings. Everybody has to be informed, the additional towns have to be informed. But at this point in time, nothing like that's either been proposed or talked about. Yeah, Ann?
There are actually leases outside the wind overlay zone.
In the town of Parishville?
I believe so. And Parkman.
Do you know if there are leases for, studies, areas?
No, they're not for studies.
Okay, I don't know anything about that. Public directory.
There's one, I think, recorded yesterday, maybe.
Well, they can't do it in our town outside the zone, so...
Right, well, I'm just saying that they have leased properties around the wind overlay zone.
I know they have had leases for, so they can, do bird studies, site view studies and like that. But that's all I've heard of. Luke?
Has Hopkinton, communicated with you at all about their new wind law or not? Are they just keeping to themselves on this?
We have talked to them, and, but, as far as, at this point in time, I don't think they haven't actually submitted their final proposed, wind recommendation law to the town, so...
Right, but it is on the website, just so you know, if you're so bored that you need to go out and...
I have seen an earlier version of it, but I haven't seen a late version.
Fred, the other question I had too was, my understanding is that they have the right to go through state lands and lay their lines to connect each of the windmills.
Yep, that's real property discussions with the state of New York.
If there's no right of way existing, I doubt it would happen. It would be a long convoluted process because even the state forest land, the land outside the park, is protected by the state constitution. And I know if there wasn't existing easement when the land was purchased, but unless Governor Cuomo pushes a lot of stuff, I don't see that happening. Mike, would another ex-DEC employee, would you?
Look, state's owned it probably for 80 years.
Yeah.
Close to that.
Yep.
They couldn't get
through the grant. Anything's possible.
Yeah.
They couldn't get through the state land grant, and they actually applied and could not do it.
And I know that years ago when I was working here in Parishville, just to get the power line up the Kingsley Road in Hopkinton, we went through a whole bunch of stuff, even though there was an existing easement across that property for power, specifically for power, so. Could it happen? Yes, but I kinda sincerely doubt that it would happen that way, even though our governor does seem to really wanna push this, but he's gotta do something even with the Constitution, so.
I'm new to the whole wind conversation, so is there a representative from the company here tonight that will be taking questions?
Anybody here from Avangrid? They usually send a couple people, and I did email them about the meeting.
Oh yeah, figures the one night I come down, they're not here, huh? No, I have some concerns from an economic standpoint that I was hoping to address with them and get some answers, but.
They are having a, when's that on, March?
March 7th, I think.
Yeah.
March 7th is the next one.
They're having a meeting in Coffee.
Open house.
Yeah, no.
Two, four in the afternoon, 6:00 at night. And bring your questions, we'll be videotaping it.
Bring your questions?
Bring your questions.
Okay.
But we'll have people sign it out then also.
Okay, great, thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, we're gonna move on with our regular meeting here. We have the minutes of the November 16th, 2016 meeting.
I'll make a motion on the minute.
I'll second it.
In favor? Anyone opposed? That got passed. And, as far as the unfinished business, we're just gonna start reviewing our new energy facilities law. Now, since this has started, we've had a couple of work sessions, we've been given a ton of information. I mean, we've got stacks of it that we printed out and twice as much, maybe three times as much of that that we see on the web. So what we've done is, all the members have gone through it, and had a couple of work sessions where we discussed some of the information that we've looked at. And at a work session, we can't make any decisions, we can't do any formal business. But we did discuss things that we liked, and Sherry cut and pasted some of that stuff into a working document. This is our very first rough draft, and what we are thinking about right now is how we should proceed from here. Okay? So, proceed from here. So,
do you want to just read the changes?
Well, they're not. If there's some changes yet, we can discuss and propose one by one. Okay? Yep. The first big change that I did was I made a table of contents. Alright. Now this is in Article 1 on page 2. And we just reworded the name of the law and cited the more current laws that it gives the town authority for this local law. In definitions, on page 4, we added a definition of Article 10, and a definition of a DBA, or A-weighted vehicle. And that's it, I think, the definition. Is there anything else we had that we talked about? I'm up to page 6. And then under permits required, we reworded section 6, article 2, section 6, paragraph C. Because when the law was originally written, we didn't have a wind overlay zone. So we put the fact that we do have a wind overlay pretty much between stuff guys for a while here. And then we noted that in Article 2, Section 10A, Paragraph A, we mentioned that we do have a wind overlay zone now. Then on page 8, Section 11, Paragraph A, we did cite that an application for special use permit for individual WECs, which is a wind energy conversion system, shall comply with all aspects and requirements of Article 10 of New York State Law of 2011, and shall also include the following, and that's when we go back to our original law and all the stuff we want. Now, this means that the applicant still has to go through the town. They have to go through the Public Service Commission, but they also have to go through the town planning board and town board. I don't think we did anything as far as the requirements. They were pretty stringent to begin with. So. I'm up to page. Application review process, no changes. The standards, that's what we didn't need. This is on page 14. Now, remember, this is just a rough draft document, something to start with. None of this is set in stone. This is something we wanted to get out there for people to look at. So, the standard for your WECs. The following standards shall apply to all WECs. And we went through A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, all. Similar to what we did in the past. The siting goals, the recruiter of the New York State Department of Ag and Markets. Construction requirements are all the same. Restoration requirements we added after construction because it was confusing. We thought the restoration requirements were for decommissioning, but that was not the case. Restoration requirements after construction. And the 2-year modernization. But we get into the fence on Article Section 14.
Yeah.
We added a 6-foot high fence with a blocking portal driveway required to enclose each tower or group of towers. And this is what we added. Unless the landowner requests no such fence to allow convenient access to those areas for farming. This means that the wind company does have to fence the thing unless the landowner doesn't want the fence. Crafters is saying, now we're down to number 16. So we have a noise standard and setbacks for wind energy conversion systems. Okay. Mike.
The total sound pressure level generated by a WEX and sources unrelated to the turbines shall not exceed those LEQA weighted decibels, dBA, listed below, measured at 10-minute intervals at the nearest property line, school, hospital, church, or public building existing at the time of application, not on site. Independent certification shall be required before and after construction demonstrating compliance with this requirement. that the ambient noise level measured at the nearest such structure, the standard.
Yeah, we got the standard replaced.
The standard is standard.
Okay, cross it out.
Shall be equal to the ambient noise level, 45 dBA, between the hours of 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., 40 dBA between the hours of 7 a.m. and 7 p.m., and 35 dBA between the hours of 10 p.m. to 7 a.m.
Just like that? Okay, we're going to move on to D and C, you're all the same. Now we get down to number, on page 22, 16, the setbacks. We got, this is everybody's going to want here, it's 16E4, we got the setback, 2,500 feet from the nearest off-site residence existing at the time of application, measured from the exterior of such residence. An owner of a residence may waive this setback requirement by a written recordable agreement with the applicant, which shall further require a resolution of the town planning board consenting to the waiver of the setback. And then 1.5 times the total height of a WEX from any non-WEX structure or above ground utility. Now here's another one. This is something that the board wants to put in. Any agreement between the applicant and the landowner to waive any of the above setback requirements shall run with the land and be recorded as part of the chain of title in the deed of such a property. Now, we added another section, section 17, on noise compliance monitoring. And that's a couple, three paragraphs. And that was prepared by an attorney.
Who's the attorney?
Attorney that the town, Rodney, the town did hire this attorney, Mr. Malusky.
Yes.
His name is Mr. Malusky.
He's working in conjunction with Roger Linden.
Yes.
The town's attorney.
Hopkins has the same one.
Do they?
Hopkins does, yeah.
Okay, I didn't know that.
And he formerly worked for the town council.
Cool.
But he also, on the other hand, he also was the Adirondack council attorney for years that I dealt with.
Oh, yes, good guy.
Same guy.
Didn't know that.
Which is kind of funny.
We're going to find the other. No. That one, I think we're probably going to use, get this out for here for everybody to look at, all right? Like I said, we got to get something officially done here. All right. So this is section 17. This is something we're going to want to look at when you guys get this. Issues of special use permits, that's the same. Variances are all the same. Section 20. Big thing problem we had with the old law was the we didn't have any decommissioning. I got this abatement decommissioning from actually I got it from Tori Witherell. She sent me this. And it's almost exactly what the word from something I got from Avangrid. And it's pretty unbelievable that they actually go through to be on the same thing. But it's almost what the limitation of from property that didn't change. Okay, now we're getting to Article 3, the wind measurement powers. We didn't make any changes there. Application review process, no changes there. And we didn't make any changes to falling energy. Man, all that time we spent on that, that's only. Can you leave it? guys didn't see anything that we missed?
No.
Sure, you put together a cut and paste in there, sure, you didn't miss a couple pages. Okay, 37 pages. What if we, if rather than go through each one of those again and go down and one by one, what we just take a blank and vote to pick us out for people to look at?
Do you want a motion on the changes or?
Could we have some discussion before you vote on that?
Well, that's what we want to do, we want to do something else.
Yeah, this is in no way, shape, or form the final version. This is our first throw out there for everybody to look at and comment on.
I would like your comments. Website, written, now you want responses, has to be organized.
Or a work session with the public? Isn't a work session supposed to open to the public even though the public cannot speak?
Yeah, we had, our work sessions have been open to the public, and they can speak too, but we only have one.
The work sessions are open to the public.
But we didn't move anything.
Friends, is it safe to say this is pretty overwhelming stuff? It's a lot of information.
That's why we wanted to get it out there.
What about a moratorium for a year? What's your opinion on that?
Let's get through this first, then we'll talk about the moratorium, because I would call that new business. It's not even on our agenda, but it's kind of important.
Could you repeat the setback, Phil?
Yes, I didn't understand it either.
Basically, the setback is 25 to 100.
Yeah, but what's the waiver? What's the waiver? The landowner can sign a, something for a waiver.
The landowner, adjacent landowner can waive that back.
Or adjacent landowner, okay, I didn't hear that part.
Yes, yes.
So that means they could put them right up to the line?
That was something that the lawyer from 2011 wanted in there. And left in there.
I didn't know about this until like September, October, so.
We're going to be discussing in length as the other parties look at this.
Can I say something before you even?
Sure, John.
I've watched some videos of these things, the braking system going out of these. And these windmills that they're proposing are 180-foot wings.
Blades.
Yeah, the wings are 180, the fins. If they overspeed and come apart like the videos that we've probably all seen, there's no way that those parts aren't going to fly a lot further than 2,500 feet.
I don't know. I that's something.
I mean, it's just common sense. These things just,
okay,
they overspeed and
yeah,
they just
I understand,
totally
yeah.
come apart. It's crazy.
You have a window. There is a big.
But yeah, we get information. We get tons of information.
I am, yeah.
One guy says, no.
Right.
And then the other stuff contradicts everything you said, so.
But you have a paper from Terry Matilski, who is a
there's people out there a lot smarter and more involved and more informed in this than we are, and that's why we want to get it out. We want some input on it.
Well, I'm very concerned about the health aspect. Even if you don't worry about a blade hitting someone or ice roads or anything like that, it's scientific knowledge that people get sick from these things.
Yep, then there's also contradicting information. You can have one family living next door to these
That's
things,
true.
500 feet away, another family at half a mile away, and a half a mile away family are sick and the one next door.
So as I was saying, the terrain affects the way the sound
is. Exactly, and that's something that...
Have you ever spent a day or two on the subway system?
No, not the subway system.
Okay, it's like living in the subway. That's the noise.
Go ahead.
Can I finish? The World Health Organization is recommending a 2-mile setback.
Okay.
And that's a fact.
Pardon? I just found a typo, that's all. I just terrible cherry over
here.
Yeah, you're good. Another thing about this, as we put up, because we cut and pasted stuff, the outlining isn't exactly right. There's going to be some numbers off and stuff. But we did that rectified. momentarily. But, are we over there making no changes so we can, go ahead, Ann.
And there's nothing in there of low frequency either.
On what?
Low frequency noise, it's only based on audible noise.
Well, yeah, the noise monitoring section.
That's all BDA. We're not talking about BDA.
That's audible noise. That's the audible noise, that's not the noise that you hear when the car has the bass on really loud and your heart starts pounding in your chest.
The infrasound frequency.
Yeah, is there a way to measure that?
Yes, it's a filter rather than A.
Well, maybe we should, you guys give some more specific language, and we get a lot of criticism.
Well, as I say, they have to measure the C filter and you're off.
Go ahead.
Can I suggest that when you take, go out and take your own measurements, but do not alert the wind companies that you're going to take them in our area for ambient noise or in a wind farm, a turbine, because they have the power from their cell phone to manipulate the towers that you're around and they slow them down. They also bring in people that have leases and their leases say that they have to promote the project, so you're going to get a very biased amount. So I highly recommend that you get your own equipment and you go and do your own investigation, but do not tell the wind company, hey, I'm coming to your project, because you'll get completely different results.
Yeah, I did correspond with Supervisor Natalia, Chair Busco, and Chattagay, and they actually they bought their own monitoring equipment. And
they don't have the low end, they don't have one that maybe will learn the sound. Rick James is actually sending to Chattagay, to Kevin, two of the monitors that measure both.
Maybe we can blow it or something.
Well, it's going to be costing us about $2,500 for each machine for him to have for 2 weeks and then for Rick James to have it analyzed. Rick James is a very well-known person who studies at acoustical engineer.
Go ahead, Luke.
What I'm wondering is, do we have time to work on this wind law? Or are they just about ready to go into the application phase and kind of be able to use the old wind law? Is there some way we're going to have enough of time?
Well, that's why we had our work session, session last week, and we wanted to have a meeting so we could get something going.
Yeah.
And doing the soonest night we could have, because we have to advertise as a public meeting, we have to have at least 3 business days, and then we have to have access to this room, and tonight was as soon as we could get it.
Yeah. Do we have any idea how much time they ask?
Yes.
I have no idea. From what I've been, what I've heard at the same meetings you go to with Avangrid, they do anticipate having a proposed site plans by midsummer. And then they have to go through the whole process with us because they have to apply through us for each tower and the town of Hopkinton and the Public Service Commission. But they don't anticipate breaking ground until spring of 2018.
So what I was wondering is, at what point does the existing law stand where they can say, we got our permit under such and such existing law, and anything we change in the future don't mean anything for that particular application? That's my question.
Yep.
I'm wondering how much time we have. Then I know.
Yeah, who would you ask that?
Tom Weitz will say that he thinks that April the 4th is some major change.
Who's this?
Tom Weitzel. That there's something going to happen on April the 4th. Maybe somebody knows what that is. They might know.
It's on the state website where all these filings are.
Yeah, I know that. We've seen that, but as far as...
They entered their preliminary plan and they entered a request for intervention from Article 10. And they plan to file their final plan between March 3rd and March 6th.
March 3rd and March 6th.
Yeah, I don't think so, because they just hired the surveyor, they can't, there's no way they'll have it.
That's their application, that's the key.
That is their final plan.
Times of the application.
Preliminary scoping process that they're submitting.
Yeah, that's what I read, I didn't hear anybody.
I think that's what it is, the application.
Construction plan, they're far on the construction. Because they're.
Yeah.
They haven't told the landowners where they want to put the towers yet.
Did you guys happen to put any type of land value guarantee in that?
Actually.
I did not hear that when you were going.
No, we don't have one.
Do you think it would be a good idea?
We looked at one, and the county planning board is going to help us build one up. But as.
So that can be included into this?
It can, yeah, this is just preliminary, this is, like I said, this is just something that.
Yeah, because just like 2 days ago, I read where Chattagay, they did, Clarkson did a study for there, and their, the average devaluation of property around these.
Yeah, I know.
Is around 20, or I'm sorry, 38% loss.
Yeah.
And we just can't do that to people.
We've read that down.
Okay. We don't know who.
I could probably, I can't even say how many pages, you have to measure things or something.
I know, I know, 2,500.
Fred, I can tell you that in our law, we did add something in there on the property values, and the planning board picked it out. And I haven't heard back from the attorneys yet, but the planning board said that won't go. The county planning board.
Yeah, the county planning board, okay, I haven't talked to them personally, but I did hear that they are going to help your town. And they're going to help, when they help you, they're going to help us too, that's why we want this over to them.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, this is what we're going to work on. If we get something out there, formally out there for everybody to look at, we're going to send a copy to the county planning board. Town board's meeting Tuesday, that's another reason why I wanted to meet tonight, so we can give this, you know, go get on record that the town has something to work with. And I think put it on the town website.
So did you say you are sending this to the county planning board?
To members of the, no, I wouldn't call it county planning board, the planning office. Not the county planning board, the county planning office. This, we're not asking for the formal county planning board review. We just want to, we got some pretty intelligent people there, and we're asking them for help. Okay? Understand that?
Yeah, but it still has me really worried.
I understand, because they don't have experience with that either.
Yeah, well.
But they have a broader planning experience than we have, so every little bit helps.
But not with Waymo.
Well, still, every little bit helps.
We need more protection than 2,500 feet, that just, that doesn't even begin to protect the residents of the town.
We've got some, we've read stuff where, from some other attorneys to other towns, where if you make it so strict, you can use, if you're strict at one, all right, you make it so strict, the public service commission will just throw it out. So rather than be so strict, we're going to lose it, we're trying to be strict enough that, or tight enough that we can really stick to our guns. Hey, this is preliminary.
We just looked at, Fred did a little thing, just for instance, Fred did a little thing. In our wind zone, he took, at the time we were talking,
Well, we took the.
3,000 feet, 2,000 feet we had in the past, and 3,000 feet, and put circles from all the residences. And there wasn't much area left. You know.
After the meeting, I can show you some stuff.
But that's not going to help when you got a good neighbor, you know, two people signing.
Well, it still has to be, if you're not a good neighbor, it still has to be so far.
From my property, but if you got too close together that it's signed, then your circles, you can throw them away.
Oh, yeah.
But, we also say, if you sign a waiver, you gotta go to the town to get the waiver okay. True?
True, if you.
If you have money, you can just fight that.
2,500 feet is from the person's wall.
Yeah, go ahead, Lou, sorry.
Yeah, I'd like to point out about the 2,500 feet. I got some maps too and did circles around the residences. At 2,000 feet, they got some room. At 3,000 feet, they might will go back to Spain because there's no room for them.
Yep.
At 2,500 feet, there probably isn't much room for them unless they get the waivers. If they get the waivers, they got lots of room. If they don't get the waivers, they probably won't like it. But then the question is, if you sign the contract says if they, if the wind company would ask you to get a waiver from the town, you would have to go for it. You would have to try to get it. So then again, it would be up to the town to say no.
Yeah.
And you would probably have some steering or something.
Try to keep as much control as you can.
Yeah.
How far does the ice throw for one of those when we have an ice storm?
Well, according to an engineering study that was done by the state of Massachusetts, by independent physicists and engineers, they computed that would go no more than like the tower.
I don't believe that.
Now, another study.
I don't believe that because.
You don't believe it?
What I've read, they can throw up to 3,500 feet.
In a vacuum.
Well.
In a vacuum, right?
It would throw 3,500 feet.
In a vacuum.
And what happens, and who's liable if that hit a car or some, the neighbor's home?
Probably the owner.
The thing is, that's a study in Massachusetts.
Excuse me? You got that in writing?
What?
The owner of the wind company would be liable?
What are you asking me? I don't know. You got.
Don't know about.
There's a lot of questions out there, a lot of questions.
You asked the same study.
Well, as a homeowner, I mean, these kind of questions need to.
From the residence or from a property line?
Right now, we have it from the property line.
No.
I don't think you're about that.
But it doesn't.
Yeah, the reason we changed, you're right, we discussed that.
Because you've made somebody's property, if that goes through, you made somebody's property unusable because if their house is over here, then all this part of their property is now unusable because it's not closer to 2,500 feet. They're gonna be paying taxes on it, but yet can't use it, can't put a dwelling on it, can't divide up their land. It shouldn't be a problem.
Good point.
Yeah.
That's something you should write and tell us that so we can say, yeah, she gotta get the money.
Yep.
Okay.
That's what we're looking for.
Yeah.
That's good info right there. To go back on, you know, throwing ice.
Go ahead, sorry.
No.
Go ahead, finish your thought.
Just going back on throwing the ice, that's not us. You can't ask us that because we're not the wind company. You can't ask us those kind of questions because we don't know who is responsible for throwing the ice. It would not be us, of course. So you have to go back on your question. To step back on a couple of questions here. When throwing ice, that is not a question for us we can answer. That is, you're gonna have to go talk to the wind.
Nobody's been able to answer that question.
But again, we cannot answer that. We are not the wind company. We are not responsible for, we do not own the towers.
You have that in the office and it's done by Terry Matilski, who's a PhD professor at Rutgers in physics.
I understand that. But again, she asked us who's responsible. We're not responsible.
I gave it to him.
We don't know that.
Yeah, but do you know the answer?
I cannot give you that answer because we're not the wind.
Yeah, Lou.
Okay.
Yeah, I was wondering if the board, the planning board will make somebody available to work with the members of the public on an evening in this room and go through our concerns at that point. Our big concern tonight is that this not be so delayed or so far ahead that the wind company can step in and use the old rules or say that, you know, well, you don't have rules and so we're going ahead.
Well, we've got, we've got an existing law. We have an existing law.
I know there is an existing law, but it's not very strong, no offense, guys.
Okay, I think the point is then is we should do what we have to do on this. And we'll move on and start talking about the moratorium. Because that seems to be the big issue right now, too.
We have to balance the comprehensive plan with that because they don't match.
Okay, good.
Let it be open.
Yeah. I guess we get a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Mike's making a motion.
In favor?
That we,
Pass this on?
Recommend that this be reviewed by various parties. Make it public.
Yep, yep.
She would say that it is a work in progress, so it is on official record that it's a work in progress, that you're making.
Yes, this is only a draft.
It's a rough draft.
Do we have word in your motion so that it's official?
Okay.
Please.
That it's the first draft?
It's always gonna be a draft anyway, until the town board passes this. This is just our work on the town board's law.
Okay, she's printing this out, and I have it in a PDF, you know, I'll print it on a PDF, and, Joan knows how to put it on the website, we'll put it on the town website. I'll email it to Doug and Lori, they know how to disperse it, right?
Lori does.
And we'll get a copy to the county planning board, office, I'm sorry, county planning office. Town board's meeting on Monday, and we'll give them, or Tuesday, we'll give it to them.
All right, Tom, just a quick question. Did you say just a little while ago that the wind company is already surveying the land?
Yeah, they hired some land surveyors, yes.
So they're doing that now before this is all in place, why is that?
So pretty soon it's gonna happen.
Has anybody here in Parishville received a letter from the surveyor? Okay, yeah.
Okay, they, you have to?
Yes.
Have you worked with a few associates?
Yeah.
Yes.
Have you worked with them at all?
Yeah, I have worked with them, I not worked for them, but I worked.
I understand. Are you familiar with them? Are they gonna come through and paint all the property lines orange now, regardless of the property?
No, I know the kind of work they do.
Where are they out?
You're lucky if you can find some flagging when they.
Where?
Yeah.
I just wonder why they don't use more local surveyors.
Yeah, it's Atlantic Testing, Spencer Thew's son.
So again, the why do you think they're doing that now before everything else is in place? It hasn't been approved, their project hasn't been approved yet.
They haven't even applied yet.
Yeah, so why are they doing?
And they're already surveying.
I interrupt you.
The project wasn't approved, so they put up.
Yeah, go ahead.
I talked to the surveyor, and I had a long discussion with him. The reason they're doing it is, they got to do their plan, and they need to know where everything is at so they can do their plan. Plus, he said, so they know which other properties they need to target to get them signed up to make their plan work. That's what he told me. That was just over the phone, you know, just two guys talking, he seemed like a real friendly person. That's what I learned.
Yeah, that's what they're doing.
Real quick, in all this, I haven't heard, like I said, I'm new to the process, so excuse me a minute. How much of this power are we getting?
Zero.
Zero.
That's a problem.
No, they say we're not getting any, and the wind company says we'll probably be getting it first. Because electricity takes a path, and least resistance, when you plug something in, you get the power from the nearest generator.
24 hours a day?
And once again, this is, excuse my ignorance for asking, but does that mean that we, if this goes through, again, if this goes through, then those that are in the area that have these towers are gonna get reductions in the national grid? Once again, another problem.
Yeah, you'll be paying more.
Another problem.
They're guaranteed to get at or lower than the wholesale price by all the subsidies that New York State puts out in terms of government. And to make up for those subsidies, and you get those surges on your electric bill, it's paying them. So they're getting paid at the wholesale price, and they're getting money from everybody's electric bill.
Okay.
See, she knows a lot of that.
If you look at your electric bill right now, I think that there's, that's RM.
Yes, RM.
And in the end, the electric bills are all gonna be higher. The more green energy, so-called green energy, the higher the electric bill goes.
What's scary is over in Chattagay, they shut power dams down when they got these online. What happens if they shut our power dams down here?
Who's gonna shut the power dam?
There was shattered, there was power dams in Chattagay area that were shut down when those went on.
They never seen it.
Yeah.
If the wind's blowing in Chattagay, cotton rise, then, and in the Cena, and they actually have to knock the water level down and not, and let more water pass because there's not enough line to carry the electricity.
Power out.
That's right.
The ones in Chattagay.
I've already heard that.
Why would they do that?
Because it's princess power.
You're making money, you're not here to help.
Right, because they're making money off the subsidies.
Basically, the hose is just making, you can only push so much water.
Right.
Because of the variability of the wind and what.
Yeah, I understand the variability, but I.
It gets priority.
I thought the lines couldn't handle that much, that's why they're allowed to put that much.
And the ones in Chattagay, what we have.
Moratorium.
These are not needed at all.
So they made a motion on the table. Has there been discussion and a vote on it?
No.
No.
Can we let them do that so we can get to the business?
One more thing.
Okay, we're gonna have to, give us a couple minutes here, right, please?
Yeah, we're trying.
All right, we've got a motion on the table. I'm gonna read and share your, This, recommend this first draft be reviewed by various parties. Okay? Oh, okay, and public. All in favor? I guess that's carried. Okay, now we're on new business. We had our agenda none at this time because we didn't have any plan, but I guess you guys were talking about the moratorium. Luke, you know more about the moratorium. Want to just mention what it is?
We've received an official form for the town to the town board to declare a moratorium, which gives us a year to work on these issues and figure it out, get things hammered out, get the real information, do our own study, and line things out a lot better, because the attorney we hired has said a rush job only benefits the applicant, and we can all lose, and that's what we're trying to get across. So it never makes waste. That's the bottom line, and we don't want to get bulldozed or buffaloed or stampeded into things that we don't know about. And we're learning more and more. Just in the last 6 months, we've learned so much. And another year would give us time to really know what we're talking about. And, you know, we don't want to have you guys, like, sounds like a prison sentence, I know. But all of us, most of us anyway, intend to live here the rest of our lives. And this is something that will affect both towns the rest of our lives, and other people's lives too. Some of you have kids, and if you want Parishville and Hopkinton to be decent places to live for the next 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years, I think this is it, and we got to do it absolutely right. There's weaknesses in the law that not your fault. You were given it by somebody else. You're doing the best you can. I think we all understand that, but we're freaked out. We don't want to get pushed into this before we've got the proper control and safety guards and things up. And so please don't take it like we're against you guys, but we can't let the company take over our town. And this whole Article 10 thing, it's just insane that the state can step in and make us do something we don't want with land we purchased and worked hard for. Some of us lived in tents for years in order to afford land here. I'm not kidding. And so, you know, this is really important. And we understand you guys have got a big, big job and heavy, you know, heavy stuff on your shoulders and pressure, intense pressure coming from a lot of directions. But we can't let
50 or 60 landowners ruin the place for 4,000 or more people. And including people who don't even vote, but they do pay their taxes. And I think that's another important thing, that we're all taxpayers. And these people, Avangrid doesn't intend to pay any taxes. Sorry.
Can I repeat?
Where was I starting? I don't know where I started, I'm sorry.
We need more time to make informed decisions.
Yes.
Well, can I ask?
Let me ask you something, Rodney.
Moratorium.
Have you guys put the moratorium on your agenda for?
Yes, that is a town issue.
Yes.
The town has spoken with our attorney, with the attorney that Mr. Linden hired to assist him with this project. And we run several risks with moratorium. First of all, I'd like to know, where was everybody 9 years ago when this project started? Why in the last?
I was with you, I was with the company.
It was rhetorical, okay? Why in the last 6 months has everybody decided to get all fired up? If we were to file that moratorium right now, you know what the state's gonna tell us? You know what that planning board's gonna say to us? Where was everybody for the last 9 years?
So it probably will be discussed at the town board meeting.
It will be discussed at the town.
Okay. All right, there it is.
Yeah, because Clayton had issues because they tried to extend the moratorium. The original moratorium wasn't an issue. It was the extension.
Yes, it was the extension because they continually fired. They had a moratorium. I went to the first Clayton meeting, I'm going to say in 2005. So
their moratorium has been...
No, they didn't do a moratorium until much later, I want to say in last
year. Right,
yeah. It was quite a few years before they did a moratorium.
Right, once the production tax credit expired at the end of 2011, everybody stopped what they were doing and went off. Because there was no threat.
Because the company stopped.
That's what happened.
The idea that you want to ask for because you might be told no is ridiculous.
It's not that I might be told no. It's that I might lose a little bit of control that I do have over this whole project and what's going on.
The risk is more than that?
And yeah, okay. Showing your support to your constituents that you care more about them than what the state has to say.
Well, it's beyond the scope of a planning board, I guess.
Nobody has gotten and had any problems with one original moratorium. It's just the ones that were extending it in Clayton. Like I said, I did the first presentation in Clayton. I remember the first town board meeting when nobody in town knew about it. And that was back in 2005. So they had been, you know, they already had laws in place, and they did the moratorium just this past year when they knew the PTC was coming back. And I'm going to tell you, the reason that Avangrid is in such a hurry now is because Trump is taking away the PTC in his 100 days. We have been working with him as a national organization. We've been working with his men since the day he got elected. And he's already taken steps and fired people that were responsible for naming the PTC and what it would be. He's already fired them with his hiring freeze. They can't be replaced.
Yeah, now you're talking politics, that's beyond our...
this is the reason that they are all of a sudden race running in.
The finish. Yeah.
But I am involved in that, so that's why...
Okay.
Where we were 5 years ago, 7 years ago, whenever it was getting abused by Marsh and Russ at Hopkinson. So
we were there. Don't take it out on me.
I said Marvin. Yes.
Okay, we appreciate everybody's input, but we're just going around in circles and preaching to the choir here, I think. So what, how you can help is, this is gonna be on the web, I'm gonna email it to the people that I know who have contacts with the rest of you, and take a look at it, go through it word by word, and send us some recommendate. I don't wanna hear more and more pro-wind, anti-wind stuff, I wanna see language, I want, we need some, what language you think that's gonna stand up.
And that's what I was trying to get at with what I was going with the moratorium. I need language that says the town is protected if we say we wanna do a moratorium, or we want, you know, I need language that says we're protected. If the siting board says we can't do that. I emailed Lori Litherall a couple of different times and told her what I was looking for, you know, and that's it. You know, I need something that when I go to the attorney, you know, this is what's being suggested, you know, help us out with this, help us make this.
Now, who is that?
At a matter of not wanting to make it happen, but I don't wanna go so far that we lose public control, so, you know, and you run that risk.
Well, have you seen the moratorium that was presented by?
Got it right here.
From the fellow from Casanova?
Yes.
Good. But it hasn't gone to the town attorney yet?
Yes, he has actually got it.
Okay, so he's given you his view?
On the moratorium, yes, he has given me his advice.
Okay, and can we send his advice to the other attorney, to the attorney who wrote that moratorium?
We can if he wants to do it, yes, then.
Oh, we gotta ask Molesky.
What do you guys wanna leave?
Okay, sorry. Sorry to interrupt, guys, we're just talking about the moratorium, sorry.
You can dump.
Morning.
I don't know how long it's gonna take us to make these modified changes, I'll talk to town board after they look at it.
What email address should people be sending their comments to? Regarding the draft?
Sure, you want?
You can send it to me, I know, fairly well.
Yeah, Connie can regurgitate stuff real well. Why don't you just send it to the town clerk, and she knows what to do with it.
That's what we all see, so.
Yeah, we all see it.
Can I just tell you one thing? What we were told by some other towns to successfully defend themselves, is that, you, rather than just having a wind lock, what you need to do is to, look at all the nuisance things that would come from wind towers, the noise, the flashing lights, the infrasound, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
And incorporate it into your comprehensive plan.
Yeah, see, there you go, you say, you should incorporate it into your comprehensive plan, but you don't give us language.
No, I know, no, this is.
You're telling us guys.
That's okay, this is your law. What you're saying is right, so.
And that's the point of the moratorium.
What do you want us to put in there, that's what.
The original zoning law would have made these.
Give us that language, so we can put it, so we can look at it, and give us that, write it down for us.
Right.
When you say light nuisance, that's not telling us, so then when we get to this, we get to this.
Fred, didn't Lori send you something?
We have a comment that says.
Didn't Lori send you something?
Certain decibel level, or certain.
You wanna know what your nuisance, what, the definition of what you're saying is, that's what you want.
What she's talking about, instead of having a separate wind lock.
Oh, yeah, I know exactly.
That's what she's talking.
The moratorium, instead of just a wind lock.
So that's, it's already, you've already been given.
You're picking on us and being unduly responsible.
A letter saying.
You're putting it as part of anything that wants to come to ground.
Yeah.
That's what you should do, is to get to it, correct?
Yeah, whether it was.
You want it written the way it, in the code, you want the code written for you, right?
No, come up with a paragraph you like, send it to us, don't have to say, I wanna see the board.
When, now after we.
Go ahead. Joe, sorry.
I think we're, you know, it's getting a little. So what Fred's saying, you got something to say to them, write it down, send to them, and what I can gather from Rodney is that he said he's talked to moratorium, he's gonna talk to his board,
and he's got a copy of the letter from the attorney that said it has worked great without any side effects whatsoever. So write yourself down, get it to Fred. Connie.
This is Connie.
Then we'll all get it.
Okay, buy a car. Okay, we're gonna talk inside, bring up, how long you think it's gonna take us to get this ready to send to, town board and the town board formally that,
A year.
Maybe we can find out.
I can send it by email to the town board and your attorney.
Yeah, maybe not yet, we're not ready.
When you're ready.
Yeah, I just know if we have to do it before a town board meeting or do it formally at town board meeting. I mean, do we have to vote, hey, this is the planning board vote to send it, or can we just send it to you guys, let you hash it out?
Send it for review.
Okay. So,
Fair law.
Yes, fair law, everyone's passed, we just kind of help put it together.
Got a question back here from the honorary.
Just wanted to say, you know, the county, planning office has stated that Parishville and Hopkinton's wind laws are very sound and strong. And I'd like to reiterate what Fred said earlier. If we make the laws too strong, too stringent, the power commission is gonna deem that, invalid. And they're gonna tell us what we can do. So we have to be careful when we're writing these laws. And I know these guys are doing a great job. I have to applaud you guys for the work you're doing, and thank you for it. But we just have to be careful what we put in there for language, because if it's too long, we're not bargaining in good faith. And the Power Commission is going to tell us what we can do. And I think some of you have stated that earlier. We do have to keep that in mind.
Credibility.
The thing is, that's not always true. Town of Brandon has not been sued. Town of Wallen has not been sued. Our tower height is 125 feet with no variance.
But you haven't been approached by a wind company, and you had wind.
Yes, we did. I fought it for 8 years there.
Yeah.
Have you seen the law? Have you seen the Malone's law banning wind towers?
Yeah, I have.
Now, we couldn't ban them, so what we did is restrict them. Yeah. And they're restricted to 125 feet tall with no variances.
But it hasn't been challenged here, has it?
They wanted 157 turbines up here.
But just
there.
At that time, you got to remember too, at that time is when some of the money went away. And all of a sudden,
no wind towers
were being built around here except for the ones that were already planned, ready for on-the-ground shovels.
We were actually the first ones planned.
Okay.
And
next
they're still putting them up in the shed again.
How long before Lori wants to get back to us on this?
A year? Can we get a year?
1 year moratorium.
1 year moratorium.
That's up to them.
Right, town board.
We have to keep moving, John, because if we don't.
No, when's the next time you guys schedule a meeting?
Well, that's what we're trying to figure out. How long is it going to take you guys to give us some info so we can get through it?
2 weeks, good.
I mean, we want some info.
Yeah, because it took us 2 weeks to go over it the first time.
Will this be immediately online?
Yeah.
Joe, as soon as he can get it on, I'll get it on.
March 15th?
What day is that on?
That's a Wednesday. That's not good.
Tuesday and fourth Tuesday.
Tuesday? Tuesday, fourth Tuesday.
March fourth.
I'm in the office Tuesday night.
Till what time?
I could be out.
You put an air on.
It's up to you.
I'm sorry, I made a mistake out.
Yeah.
Tuesday, fourth.
Tuesday, March 14th, Tuesday.
March 14th?
Tuesday, March 14th at 6:30 PM.
6:30?
Well, we're talking.
All stuff, the new stuff we get in.
New stuff we get, get over here. Yeah, motion to adjourn.
Well, new business, you said we were gonna move into new business. Comprehensive plan?
We don't have any new business.
This comprehensive plan?
The comprehensive plan is the zoning code.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you see the section that says that any webs can be 1,200 feet from the wall of an occupied house.
When we wrote that law, there was another law that was, the code had not been, the local law for the wind law had not gone through yet. However, we did cite the law in the code. So the local wind law overrides the zoning code. Whenever there's a conflict.
It doesn't override.
Yes, it does. And it does, whatever.
Comprehensive plan.
Tell her it does. Somebody sit down and tell her.
Why not just.
There's three from associations in town told this. They can.
No, they can't, Ann. Show it to me in writing, Ann. Show it to me in writing. You got my email address, I got yours.
I will call the associations in town tomorrow because I talked to the senior attorney there. And he told me it's gotta match.
Yeah, no, it does not have to match. Whenever there's a conflict, there's a lot of laws of conflict. And when they conflict, the more restrictive applies. Whenever there's a conflict in a law, the more restrictive.
The plan for your town is what applies.
Pardon?
What would be wrong with changing it so that?
We can't, we're gonna.
We're gonna, but we wanna change the wind law first.
Yeah, and then say.
What if they jump in right, let's say Monday, and file something locking us into what we have now?
We already did, we're locked in.
No, but what if the windmill does?
That's, we have pretty locked, our county plan, that record day, our law is not that bad. Yeah, go ahead.
Can the planning board make something in writing like they did about the wind law as a working process? That if the town of Parishville does implement a moratorium, it is their intention to work on their land use and development plan, quote unquote, comprehensive plan, that's one of the reasons that the public is requesting a moratorium is so that the planning board can implement some of the recommendations of the public into their comprehensive plan.
You mean put that in the moratorium?
Put that, make that a note in this, yes, make that part of the moratorium so we can review and revise our land, it's called your land use and development plan, right? I don't know if we can call it a comprehensive plan.
Would you please write down what you just said? No, I'm serious.
Yes, I can. No, I can't email it. I can't email it. I don't have electricity.
It's only like 47 lines.
Take it out.
Write it down.
All right.
Now write it down.
And bring that up, bring that up with Rod and the town board.
Okay, that's what we're doing, yeah.
Because they're our bosses too.
We just, it's not that we don't trust you guys, it's that we don't trust the wind company. They've got high-powered attorneys.
Is there any way you can put that 2,500 setback into your comprehensive plan tonight? So, because that's a little bit tighter than what you have now?
No, because to do that, to change the plan, we have to do a public hearing.
Okay.
You know, we have to go through the long process.
Okay, okay.
Public hearings, you know, post it.
We're just afraid that they'll jump in and use what's on the books now and...
Yeah, well, the best bet, from what I can see there, is the moratorium.
Yeah, and what everyone here has said is they believe the 2,500 feet is from property line, not from the outside wall.
Okay, we got a motion to adjourn, right?
I made a motion.
They don't want to.
All in favor? 8:45.
So you're giving us 2 weeks?
7:45.
2 weeks?
Yeah.
Yeah. That won't be the last thing to change.